Season 2, you heard?
I can't hear it.
There you go.
You said what?
I said I couldn't hear it.
You can hear the music at all?
No, I can hear it. I'm saying like it got low for a second. I don't know what was going on. But go ahead. I can hear it now.
Season 2 placeholder year.
All right. Is that the, you done?
Yeah.
All right. I'll play this one.
What song is this?
These Drugs. Can you hear it?
Yeah, I hear it.
Must be something in the water. Something deep. Voices getting softer. But it's a dream. I thought that I was getting better. Lost my selfish esteem. I'm better for you. The worst for me. It's the time that passes by and I'm lost in life. The doors are closing and I'm sleeping. I feel fine. It's always easier to say that these drugs, they set my brain, leave my mind. And I can't remember the last time that I cried. These drugs, ooh, they set my brain, leave my mind. And I can't remember the last time that I cried.
It's this pale
saturation. All right,
nice. Who made this one? Sugar Pine 7, it's a YouTube channel. They make comedy videos. It's like a comedy, scripted comedy YouTube channel. And every once in a while, they make songs. So they like to produce music and write and stuff and direct. So like every once in a while, they do a series of scripted comedy, like improv comedy around Los Angeles. So it's really silly. It's almost like, what is it like? Almost like kind of like Jackass, but it's not stunts. It's just like them in public acting fools. And then every once in a while they'll like drop a short film or they'll drop a music video, and that's one of their songs. They have a couple songs, really good.
Right.
Yeah, I love that song so much. That chorus slaps. Anyway, all right. 2.0. Yeah, let's go.
Season 2, as they say.
Exactly.
So I know we've been on a while, but it ain't my fault.
All right. So what were you here to talk about today? Let's not get into the nitty gritty.
Now let's get into the nitty bitty.
I will say this. I've been on a kick of watching essentially not romantic comedies, but I guess romantic comedies from at least like 20, 30 years ago. So today I watched Married with the Mob, which is a crime comedy, which is really good. And I watched a couple weeks ago, probably last week, I watched Moonstruck 87 with Nick Cage and Cher, and that was hilarious and very, very dope. And I watched The Apartment, which is wonderful. I was watching, I watched The Apartment, which is 1960, Shirley MacLaine, Jack Lemmon, black and white. And there were so many moments in that movie where they were referencing Spider-Man 2, you know, the Tobey Maguire one. I was watching it, and I was like, that shot's from Spider-Man. And it just made me love it even more. As you know, remember at the end of Spider-Man 2 when Mary Jane leaves the altar and she runs to go meet Peter?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's a part that the ending of The Apartment is literally that exact same thing. And there's a moment that I can't think of. Oh, there's like multiple moments in Spider-Man 2 when Pete and Mary Jane are having conversations that are like directly lifted. Maybe not like the exact convos, but the framing and how it's shot and how it's positioned. That's exactly from The Apartment. And I love that movie. So that's all. After I get off with you, I'm probably going to watch The Fabulous Baker Boys, 1989, The Bridges Brothers and Michelle Pfeiffer. I heard it's really good, and I'm really excited to watch it. And something else, too. What I had it. Miami Blues. I'm going to watch that, too. Anyway, go ahead. You have anything you want to say?
Yeah, man. It's been crazy. Mm-hmm. But no, I've just been I've been real big on movies lately. Not even watching them, because I don't be watching new stuff like that.
You need to be watching them.
No, I'm it's just more like I like hearing people talk about them.
Yeah.
Especially when I think they know what they're talking about. It's just, and also I just like to formulate my own opinion on them, even if I haven't seen them, which is weird. So
that's not good at all.
Yeah. No, that's actually great. And I don't mean,
I feel you. That's how I got into liking movies too. I remember it was like eighth grade, ninth grade. I started watching At the Movies with Michael Phillips and A.O. Scott, and they're writers for the New York Times and the Chicago Sun Times, I believe. Yeah, yeah. And they had their show At the Movies, and I was watching that, and I was just loving hearing them talk about the movies that were out for the weekend. And then after the show ended, I just went back and started reading old Roger Ebert stuff, because they talked about him on the show, and I didn't know who he was at the time. And I watched old clips and read his reviews, but now I just kind of don't. I have to stop myself from watching like the kind of stuff you were talking about, because I just don't want to have my mind infected by those kind of conversations. Because a lot, my biggest problem is a lot of those videos. They don't make videos about movies that I want to talk about. They make videos about movies that everybody's already seen, and I don't really like. I know what you have to say, so I just don't care about hearing them anymore.
I think that's very arrogant of you to say, I know what you have to say. They might have an idea you haven't thought about that movie. And I think you think you know more about movies than a lot of people, and you don't.
No. I'm constantly reminded about how little I know about stuff.
You said what?
I'm constantly reminded about how little I know about stuff.
You count. You believe you know more about stuff than anybody else.
Nah, I mean, there's stuff I don't agree with. Like, there's people who make claims about stuff that I'm like, that's so unfounded and like crazy. I mean, it's the same reason why I don't really want to watch like Marvel movies anymore, because it's kind of like, and I'll probably go to this and enjoy it. Like, I enjoy Captain Marvel. It was good. But like, I just don't, so much of the conversation is dominated by those things that I just want to put my attention on stuff that don't get seen as often. It's kind of what I care about.
Yeah,
go ahead.
I'm loving just hearing about cinema. I done followed like 4 pages in the last week on Instagram with like movie stuff. Mm-hmm. and a lot of news, because I love hearing like when deals get done and stuff like that, and seeing people like that I'm familiar with but don't know a lot, and then like see that what new role they got. And it's something about that. I'm just like really engrossed in the world of cinema right now. So much so that I don't think I've ever been engrossed as anything like this. Drake is up there. I've been engrossed in his music for the better part of a decade. Like, whenever something drops, I know, like, even down to like the most minuscule verse on the worst song. If it's Drake, I know it. That's how I'm with movies right now. I'm just kind of like invested, and so it's like, but more than that, because I actually want to like make them, and I want to be in them. It's like bad, so it's like it's a different feeling. Even though I think I could make music. I think that's not out of the possibility. But yeah, but it's just like it's a good time right now for that kind of stuff. So, and I'm just into it. But I'm real big on it. And I also want to start going to move to film festivals. Like, I want to go to South by Southwest this year, and I said last year I was gonna go, but I didn't. So I'm gonna say it again for next year. Hopefully that happens.
I'm sure it will.
But, I want to go to Cane's one day. I think that'd be dope.
You have to get invited there, though. They don't.
Yeah. And the New York Film Festival in Toronto International. I plan on having a movie at one of them one day anyway. I'm gonna be like, yo, how you get movies into them?
You make them and then you submit with like a submission free, and then the committee that watches the movies that get submitted, they send you a thing back saying whether you got in or not. You know.
I'm trying to do that.
I was watching I was rewatching Simple Favor, great movie with the commentary, and Paul Feig, the director of it, he was talking. He said he tried to submit to both Venice and Toronto, and it got rejected from both.
Who is this?
Paul Feig. He made A Simple Favor with Blake Lively and Anna Kendrick, and he's also made Bridesmaids and Spy and The Heat and the Ghostbusters remake, the new one with Melissa McCarthy. He makes comedies. And he was, and they were like, "Fuck the Toronto and the Venice," because we didn't get in. And Blake Lively was like, "Yeah, fuck them." It was just funny.
What do you do if your movie don't get brought into one? Like, how do you get it shown to people?
Well, Jim Cummings, who I follow on Twitter, he made a movie last year called Thunder Road, which nobody has seen. But it's an amazing movie. And I watched it because I followed him and I liked what he used to say. And I was like, I'll check his movie out. And it's so great. If you don't have time to watch the movie, Nate, there's a short film he based the movie on that's online called Thunder Road. And it's basically a scene from the movie. In the movie, it's different, but it's just as good. But the movie is amazing. But he talks about not getting into Sundance or something like that. But he talked about he got into South by Southwest, and he essentially distributed the movie himself and didn't go through any major studios or anything. And you know, he didn't like I said, barely anybody have seen it. But he's made money on it because he put it out himself and he made some money back. But most of the time, what happens is most people try to get into Sundance, submit, and they tend to not, because Sundance movies are typically of a certain quality, at least these days. And a lot of people I follow on Twitter have Sundance movies or don't or whatever, and they talk about, don't feel discouraged, submit to other festivals. You can probably get in somewhere. I mean, there's plenty of like smaller festivals that you don't know the names of or aren't super aware of that you could probably get into and have your movie seen. I mean, the thought of getting into places like Sundance or South by Southwest or Toronto or any of these places is to hopefully get in front of people who work at studios like Netflix or Amazon or Warner Brothers, and then they would buy your movie and then they would put it in theaters or on their service. So, I mean, that's kind of the goal. That's how you at least get in the door. But there are plenty of people who don't and end up being successful, like the Duplass brothers, like Joe Swanberg, who make movies that go to festivals, don't get bought, barely anybody sees, they continue to make movies, and eventually they get to a point where they can make stuff at a studio level. Like Mark Duplass, a couple of years ago at South by Southwest, he gave a keynote speech, and he talked about that we should, like independent filmmakers, should collaborate with each other and should form a community that makes itself self-sufficient and don't rely on big studios to do it. Because he says, and when he made his first movie in 2005, nobody came, he made it, he sold it, nobody gave him another job, he had to make another one, and he did that repeatedly, and now he's making shows for HBO and movies for Netflix. And he was just saying, some people happen instantaneously, sometimes you're Tarantino or the Coen brothers, and sometimes just somebody like him who makes a movie that people don't think is, worth investing, a Marvel movie into, getting you in to do certain things. So, it just depends. How it gets seen, I mean, that's really based on you. If you want to, you could probably make a movie, sell it to a cheap DVD distributor and get it made and get it seen somehow, or somehow get it toured at colleges, or send it to a small festival and get it seen there. I mean, there are a lot of movies that get made that nobody sees or nobody cares about. There are a lot of movies that get made that are really bad that I've seen, that are awful, and nobody wants to see them. So, that's the risk you run when you do it by yourself.
I feel that.
Also, yeah, Thunder Road, Jim Cummings, amazing movie, amazing, amazing movie. It's so good that it reminded me of it's set in Louisiana. It reminded me of people I knew growing up. It's it's weird how honest that movie is. Anyway, go ahead.
I say, I'm not, but
if you want to watch that short film, it's 6 minutes, and it's so good.
But so big things coming out for you soon? Anything?
Sure.
Like what?
What do you mean?
So is that big thing is coming out for you?
Like coming out, what do you mean?
like movies or something, or music or something.
No, I ain't got. Oh, you mean like that I'm looking forward to?
Yes, man.
Oh, Vigilante is coming out in like a week, I think, and I'm excited to see that. That movie I told y'all about in the group chat, Booksmart, by that Olivia Wilde directed.
Cause she's what's disrespectful?
Go ahead.
Us is coming out in a week, and you went to two white movies first.
Well, I just thought about Olivia Wilde. She's starring in Vigilante.
You thought
she
about
directed like, Booksmart, so I just thought about her. Plus, yeah, I'm excited about. I mean, that goes without saying, you know.
No, it don't. No, it don't.
All right, man. I'm super hyped for Us. There you go.
It's forced.
I'm excited about it. I hear it's amazing.
Everybody been saying it's great.
Yeah. So I'm really excited to see it. But yeah, like, I don't know. I don't really know what's coming out. Like, I'm excited to see Pika Pika, Detective Pikachu. I'm definitely going to see that. I'm kind of hyped to see, Dark Phoenix. Oh, that's probably right, because I'm not aware what, like, the smaller movies that's coming out, like, in August, October, November, all that stuff. I just don't know what those movies are yet. Probably Dark Phoenix, Us, and, like, Detective Pikachu. Probably the most hype right now. And Booksmart, because I like that trailer a lot. And I like Olivia Wilde, so I want to see her movie.
Yeah.
Music, Revenge of the Dreamers 3, whenever that drops, probably, you know, who knows. And Boss and Hicks, their collab album coming out this year, I think. And that's the most exciting. That's the most anticipated album of the year for me. Even more than Cole's, whatever he dropped.
Yeah, it's been kind of quiet for music right now.
I mean, stuff's coming out. It's just nothing I care about. Like, Offset dropped an album. I'm like, I don't care about Offset's album.
Freddie Gibbs and Madlib have put out two songs.
For Bandana, right?
Yes. And so when that drops, I'm going to be ready to say that that's going to be the best rap album this year.
I don't know. I mean, you know, Boston Hicks might. I did listen to the first one. I like the first one. Boston Hicks might drop this year, and I think that's going to be the best. Or Crit might drop something this year, and I'm excited for anything new Crit. And, you know, Virgin Dreams 3. I think JID's coming out with a new record this year, too. And Earthgate's dropping Maryland. Ari Lennox is dropping her project soon.
Word on the street is Drake coming out again this year. I don't know how true that is, but
come out every year, bro.
Yes, and that's also going to be up there for the most anticipated for me.
Yeah, I feel you. I'm always excited for new Drake.
You're not.
I am excited for new Drake.
Yeah. What I was going to say to you?
I've been saying 4 p.m. in Calabasas is a perfect song.
All right. Yeah. What you feel about that Aladdin trailer?
I don't care.
I'm all in on it, baby.
I mean, it's probably going to drop another one before it comes out, right? Oh, Shazam. I want to see Shazam. It looks.
I don't care about that at all.
Yeah, I feel you on that. I mean, I really don't care about superhero movies in general that aren't like X-Men movies at this point. But yeah, I mean, I don't care about Shazam because I don't care about Aladdin because I don't care about the cartoon, you know?
People love that cartoon.
I don't give a fuck about that cartoon.
I didn't care about that either. It was one of my least favorite Disney movies, but
It probably is. It probably better than them 90s ones. Like, I don't think it's better than Mulan, Tarzan, Lion King.
But this?
Beauty and the Beast, you know.
I'm only in it for Will.
Yeah, I want Will to do good, and I'm pretty sure it's going to make money. Like that and like that new Lion King movie? I don't give a fuck about neither one.
Oh, yeah, I care about that, too. I want to see that also.
I do not want to see that. I don't want to support. I don't want to support them.
You serious shit all the time.
Nah, bro. I'm so tired. Like that movie, like offends me, bro. Like they literally, like, we just gonna make their lines real. Like it's already a cartoon, though. Like, nah, but we gonna make them look real. Like, yeah, but that's
live action.
It's not live action because they're all animated.
No, they're not. First of all,
that movie's gonna be so trash. Part of what makes the original Lion King so good is the expressive animation. If you just make it all look real, then I don't want to see two lions fight each other. What the fuck? That just sounds awful. Who wants to watch that? That to me is like the most cynical thing ever. I really don't want to watch that movie.
Can you imagine how Scar gonna look? Oh, it's gonna look great.
Yeah, and then we gotta see Scar. Like, I don't want to see I don't want to see Mufasa get trampled. Like, that's just, I don't want to see that. Like, it's gonna look real. Like, I don't know, man. I'm just, that's a movie that makes me upset.
That's a very bitch thing to complain about.
I mean, it is. I mean, it doesn't really matter.
And about them in real life getting killed, so why you care about a damn movie?
But here's the thing. I don't want to see it in real life either. So I don't
but you care enough to go out and stop it, but you won't talk about it.
Look, Nate, I'm not. It's not. Yeah, it's none of it's real. Yeah. So I mean,
your mouth.
Look, I just don't want to. Everything's not. Everything movie wise is just kind of bumming me out. So I'm not really excited about much.
I think it's a great time for movies. I think this year gonna be huge in terms of movies.
I think in terms of like the big movies, like they all are just stuff we've seen before. Or like superhero movies that all kind of feel the same, and I'm just kind of bummed out about it. I'm excited.
If you think that's all that is out there, you just.
I did not say that's all that's out there. Who said that? I said big movies in terms of big movies. That's what I said. Yeah, man. I mean, like Dark Phoenix is probably gonna be the last X-Men movie before they get Marvel thrown into the MCU, and I'm really excited to see what that's gonna be. Even though I think that's not gonna be very good.
I don't care about that one either. You care about the trash and shit.
Nah, man, I'm so hyped for Dark Phoenix, bro.
It's not going to be good.
I don't think it is either, but I'm going to be there opening
the
weekend.
It showed the big death in the damn trailer. I was so mad about that. Like, why would y'all do that?
Who are these people who are upset at this? Who are you people? Who cares?
Why would you show the big death? That's so dumb
That's the first act. That's first
now
act.
Now you don't need to see the movie.
That's act one death, my guy. That's not
I don't need to see the movie because I know who's going to die. Mystique is going to die.
That's an act one death.
Look, and that's not enough of a reason to still show it. That's a dumb reasoning to show it.
Bruh, if we're going to do this podcast, you're just going to be like everybody else on the internet. I don't want to do that. All right? Chill out.
You try so hard to be different, you don't know that you don't make any good points at all. But you're just trying hard to be different and think that's enough.
But that's not even an issue, though. He's like, why they show the death? Like, who cares? Obviously, that happens early on in the movie.
Why would they? That's such a dumb thing to not care about, but you care about lions looking real. You so ass backwards these days. It's so you used to make good opinions. Now you're one of people who have terrible opinions.
All right, so let me ask you a question about this then. Were you upset when you saw the Spider-Man trailer, the Far From Home?
Nigga, I ain't even watched that trailer.
But you aware that it exists?
Yeah, I'm aware that shit exists.
Are you upset that it exists?
No, dumb bitch. Why would I be upset that it exists?
Because it spoils that he comes back in Endgame.
And I didn't see that. So I don't care. No.
You didn't see it. You saw Infinity War. You saw him die.
We all knew he wasn't going. So you think Black Panther going for it? If you thought that, don't.
I'm not saying that. I'm saying you saying I'm stupid for not caring about Mystique dying. I knew Mystique was going to die months ago.
I don't care that Mystique is dying. I'm saying why show it?
The point I'm making is, if they show if there's a trailer for a Spider-Man movie coming out after Endgame, then you know Spider-Man comes back.
But you knew he was coming back even if they didn't drop a trailer.
And I knew Mystique was going to die even if they didn't drop the trailer. So what is the point?
Not everybody did, but everybody knew Spider-Man get another movie, Ian. That's a different thing. That's false equivalency.
How's that a false equivalency?
And you smarter than it.
How is that a false equivalency? If I knew that Mystique was going to die, then what's the point? What do you mean?
Because not everybody knew that, Ian. But everybody knew Spider-Man getting another movie because he made too much on the first one. You know that.
Okay.
That's a false. You stupid. You making me very mad because you fucking dumb.
All right, bro. All right, bro.
God dang.
Cool.
Let's have a little knowledge on this podcast, please.
Yeah.
And like I said, let me get back to us. To talk about something intelligent.
No, man.
I think.
I don't want to do theories on this podcast. If you talk about
the best movie this year, I think it do have a chance to be the best movie this year. And just about to set Jordan Peele up. I think he could be legendary. You know what I'm saying?
I mean,
because if you go all hits, no misses, then what are we talking about? You know what I'm saying? Like, he finna do the, what's that reboot he finna do? The X-Files reboot? I don't know if that's, you know, I didn't care about
Twilight Zone.
Yeah, that one. I didn't care about that at first, but if he do something crazy with it, you know, that could be a hit. He was doing some other thing. Oh, he got the Candyman movie. Now, that could be something crazy also.
Sure.
So, we just looking at three or four projects in a row of him just knocking out the park in the span of like what, 2 or 3, 4 years. I'm like, all right, he might be up there, bro. And he knew, and that's the thing about it, it's like, he's so new to be doing all this in the first few projects he getting. If they all just go crazy, it's like, all right, we gotta start speaking about him in a different light.
I mean, nah, but I feel you.
Is it because he's black?
Nah, because I think Barry Jenkins is gonna be a legend.
I don't think you think any black director is a legend.
I think Barry Jenkins.
Other than Spike Lee.
Barry Jenkins is gonna be a legend, bro. I think he's gonna be a legend.
You don't even talk about Beale Street.
What do you mean?
Or Moonlight or any of his movies.
Yeah, I love his movies, but I don't in the same way as I talk about Jeremy. I guess I talk about him less because he has the hype already. I love Damien Chazelle as a filmmaker, right? But he has hype, like La La Land, Whiplash, First Man, like these movies people see. So I don't really feel the need to talk about his stuff that much. But I talk about Jeremy Saulnier because most people have not seen Green Room or Blue Room.
You talk about Thomas Anderson all the time. He definitely hyped. What are you talking about?
He ain't that hyped to most people. He hyped to people who know movies, but not to like the average person. I mean, Phantom Thread didn't make that much money.
You cap so much.
It doesn't make that much money. What are you talking about?
I don't give a fuck about money. That don't mean that somebody ain't known.
He's never won a Best Director Oscar. It's not like he's an Oscar winner and a dude who makes like hit movies. He's not he makes really great smaller movies. Paul Thomas Anderson. Like what movies of his do you know? Paul Thomas Anderson.
Drunk Punch Love.
Gotcha.
Off top of my head, I can't think of any, but I do know him.
Phantom Thread, you know.
But it's only because you just asked me. It's not lack of knowledge.
But okay. Well, how long has he been a filmmaker? Do you know?
He's a young guy, so I'm going to say not that long.
How long is not that long?
I don't think it's over 2 decades.
He has been making movies for over 2 decades. His first movie was 1996, I believe.
That's barely over 2 decades. So.
That's 22 years. That's 2 decades.
That's barely over 2 decades.
You said it wasn't. I just told you it was. I don't know what you arguing about.
I said
just say like, I don't know okay, why my you fault. Couldn't
be like that matters.
Just say my fault. Not. Just say my fault. That's all.
He's still known. I don't know why you quizzing me like I need to know this shit to know.
I'm not quizzing you because you need to know this shit, but you talking to me like I don't know. And I'm like,
I'm talking to you like you stupid because you are to think that he's not known. Yes,
I'm not saying he's not known. I'm saying in terms of like the hype that like
nigga, you brought up Oscar wins like Spike Lee had 4, and you gonna tell me he ain't known because he just got his first one? That matters nothing. You still making bullshit opinions on this show, and I don't like it all. I don't like none you doing right now. All right,
fine. We'll get off that.
Let's stay on it.
What you mad about? I don't understand.
Cause you pissing me off. You stupid. When you get stupid.
Who's a not known filmmaker that you know that you feel is not known?
Not known.
Barry Jenkins is like a guy who's not known, really.
I don't think he's household known, but
no, definitely not. No,
no, but people know who directed Moonlight. I think.
I don't. Yeah, maybe you're probably right.
Jonathan Demme's not known.
He's not known maybe to this generation, but that dude made like hits in his time.
He made one of the best movies ever.
He made some of the biggest hits of the 90s. Like, people knew I can't speak. People know who Jonathan Demme is.
Wait a minute, Ian. The Matrix was a hit, and don't nobody know who the Wachowski brothers are, so that don't matter either.
They're not brothers anymore. The Wachowski.
Nigga, they brothers.
I'm not doing this.
What were they born as?
I'm not doing this at all.
What were they born as?
People know who the Wachowskis are.
I didn't want you to say what were they born as.
I'm not doing this, Nick.
And people don't know. All they know is that The Matrix is one of the most famous movies of all time, and they could tell you that.
See, what's funny is, I don't know where you're getting these people don't know, and these people do know. That's what's weird about it. People know who Jordan Peele is because of Key and Peele. And
I don't know why
he also makes movies.
Well, first of all, I don't know why you think people watch movies as extensively or as old as you do.
I'm not acting like they do, Nate.
Yes, you do. You act like people know as much as you do about film.
Nate, so how do you gauge whether someone is known or not?
What you'll do is judge.
What you'll do is judge people based off of what you think about movies,
and that you can't do that because they don't think about movies the way you do. So they not worried about the what you
do. How do you gauge how someone is known? That's my question.
I don't know. I want to move on because you're stupid.
You want to move on? You said they don't know who the Wachowskis are, but they know who. But people know who Barry Jenkins is.
I think black people know who Barry Jenkins is.
I think white nerds know who the Wachowskis are.
And it's more black nerd. It's more black people who love movies. Who love the Wachowskis brothers.
If that was the case, superhero movies wouldn't be the biggest thing in the world. There are way more white nerds than there are black people in this country.
First of all, you know why Barry Jenkins, I feel like, is more of a household name than him? Because when black people get something that hits and they love it as much as people loved...
people don't love Moonlight like that, do they?
They'll go above and beyond to really know who made it and they'll champion it. And white people get so many great movies by so many great directors all the time that are celebrated. They don't give a fuck about the Wachowskis because it's another one coming right next after them. So black people really have to hold on to what they get and who making it. That's why Jordan Peele.
The Matrix changed action filmmaking, American action filmmaking, forever. It's one of the most influential movies.
People don't care about the director.
It's one of the most influential movies of all time. If you don't think that there are more people who know who the Wachowskis are than know who Barry Jenkins is, I don't know what to tell you. There are literally, if you go on YouTube, there are literally thousands of videos about how the Wachowskis directed.
Ian, so what
are we talking about? I bet you cannot find five videos on Barry Jenkins and his style as a filmmaker.
Everybody thinks about movies and watches as many movies as you do, and you're in your little bubble, and you think
Matrix was a... Hold on. No.
You think that critics make most of the movie population, and they don't. It's a lot of casual movie people watching movies, and they don't care about the Wachowski brothers, but a lot of black casual people care about Barry Jenkins. So, you wrong, and I'm right.
Let's keep it moving.
Wrong.
Anything else you want to talk about, man?
You wrong.
Cool. I agree. Anything else you want to talk about?
You said you had a bunch of shit. Why you ain't talking?
I'm just asking if you had anything else you want to bring up.
I'm ready to debate you.
I'm not here to debate, bro. I'm here to have a conversation.
No. You know how you start.
I listened to, remember that Sugar Pine 7 people I told you about who made that song Let You Hear?
No, I don't.
Well, they made a podcast. They have a podcast they do once a week, and there was an episode the other day that I listened to, and it was an episode about their relationship. The dude who runs the company is named Steven, and he works with two guys who help him run the company. He's the founder, and they're the two like other partners in it. And one of them, James, he was just like, it's a real uncomfortable episode because he calls him out for like being an asshole on the podcast and being rude and not considering his feelings. It's really interesting. Listen. Anyway, what I wanted to talk about was, so I was thinking about this the other day, and I was thinking about Ridley Scott, filmmaker, and I think he's a bad filmmaker. I think he makes really bad movies. But he's loved by most people, and he's really popular. But here's the thing. I think he's a terrible director. But I think he made one of my top 10 favorite movies of all time, which is Alien, the first one. And he directed that, and I think he's terrible, right? And I was trying to reconcile. I was like, how can he make something so wonderfully perfect, but also be such a horrible filmmaker? Because he's made good movies past that. He's made, like, Thelma and Louise is very good. He directed that. He directed American Gangster with Denzel. I think that's a pretty great movie as well. He directed Prometheus, and I really like that movie. But I just think overall he's pretty bad. And I was thinking about it in conjunction to other people. So I was thinking, here's a question to you. So for me, I realized I categorized Alien in this category of amazing, perfect films that kind of are hollow thematically, and that the interesting bits come with the kind of directness and conciseness of the plot. And the details around it, like the production design, the quality of the performances, the relationships between each other. And like, because that movie is so kind of hollow with meaning, but it's dense with circumstance, I can project onto it the meaning that I want. So like, in the movie Alien, there's the computer for their spaceship is, they call it Mother, and they go into a room and they're like, Mother, tell me the coordinates to this planet, and then it'll be a woman who talks back to them. They don't explain it. They don't say if it means anything. They don't really talk about it. It's just a thing that exists in this world. But because of my own projection, I was like, oh, okay, what does this mean in conjunction to this? And I'm able to, because of my own experience or whatever I know, to wrap into it, meaning that may not, the filmmaker didn't anticipate it being there, but he made it abstract enough so that I can project onto it. And on the direct inverse is another one of my favorite movies, which is Do the Right Thing, which is so packed and dense with meaning and thematics that every single choice made in that movie is meant to zero in on this larger scale condemnation and like a examination of society and the way we view each other based on races and like these imaginary boundaries. And I can project onto it, obviously, but there's so much there that's rich and that you can take from it and have tons to back it up with. And it's a movie that's objectively, I think, dense of thought versus Alien, which I also love almost just as much, which is so completely void of thought, and I project my own thoughts into it. So are there any movies, or can you think of examples of movies where there's some that are just so, there's so much meaning in it that that's why it's great, and that's why you attach to it, and that's why you love it? Not only that, with the form and everything. And then there are movies where the form, well, yeah, form and everything. And then there are movies that are kind of hollow of meaning that you can watch as like a pure piece of entertainment or filmmaking, and you can be like, I can take nothing from this, or I can take everything, because there's so little to grab onto that because I see this and I have my own experience, I project onto it the meaning that's there, you know? For me, so I'll just give two examples of each that aren't the two I gave. So for me, the hollowness, like a movie like Green Room, I think that's one of my favorite movies of all time now. And I think that movie has a lot in it, and it has a lot of ideas that they're throwing at you. There's also a lot that's missing on the periphery that I then inject onto it based on the experience now versus something like, I think like Revolutionary Road, which is also a favorite of mine, which is like so packed with meaning and so literary and is about something specific. And it's everything is wrapped up into that story about what it's about. You got any movies like that?
Well, these two movies, I guess, well, one directly that is so packed with meaning you can make your own thing is No Country for Old Men. I think it's so much you can take from that movie, and so much so that you can literally come to your own conclusion as to what it's about, and you won't necessarily be wrong. Uh-huh. I just think that is one of the best movies I've ever seen in my life, and I haven't seen nearly all the what they claim is great movies that are out there, but that's one of them that I can say is like, yeah, I think that's genuinely one of the best movies ever. But a movie that I guess you could also say that it's full, but I don't know, it could be dense too. It could just be your typical spaghetti western, but I think Django Unchained is like, it's one of those movies where you don't think it's deeper. It's a slave movie, so it's already deep. And it already holds a lot of hurt, but I feel like it's so much stuff that goes unsaid about that movie and the tropes of slavery. And I think that's what made Quentin Tarantino so great. It's the little things he do. And like, you know, beside all the brashness and all the F words used and, you know, all the explosions and all that kind of stuff. And all the hilarity that he brings into his films. I think that movie is so deep and so dense and so full of like turning slavery basically on its head and using its own tropes against it of the time that you'll think it's just funny stuff, and it's actually very serious. Like a lot of the comedy is like very, very serious, and small things are very, very serious. Even in Glorious Bastards, which I know I need to rewatch because I didn't give it a fair shake the first time, but I saw it, I was very young and I fell asleep, but I need to rewatch that. Mm-hmm. I remember you putting that on, and I was just like, man, I don't know how I'm gonna get through this, but now I really want to rewatch it. Mm-hmm. That movie, it's a lot of subtle things like that goes into it, and he's really good for taking like these mass atrocities and, you know, mass ideas and really using them to show why they suck. And he did that with slavery, and he did that with the whole Holocaust era and the Glorious Bastards. And, you know, all the Jewish stuff. But, but going back to Django, I think it's a movie that on the surface it probably looks like, you know, and it has great performances, things like that. I'm not saying it's a bad movie, But I think on the surface, you'd be like, oh, it's just a really good movie. It's just a really well-made movie. Like, no, I think it's very deep. And I think it has a lot of things in it that you would miss, that I would miss if I ain't really think about that movie as much as I do, which is a lot more than I would have told. I would have thought that I'd think about it back when I saw it. And I was also young when I saw it the first time. But I think it's a deep movie that a lot of people probably wouldn't think it is, based on who made it and, you know, really what it's about. I know, like, slavery is already deep enough, but I think there was another layer you went. And I think that movie is probably that. But on the other side, I think No Country for Old Men is that movie you're talking about where it's so deep you can come to your own conclusion about it.
Have you seen any of the other Coen Brothers movies?
Name some of them.
The Big Lebowski, Fargo, Raising Arizona, A Serious Man, The New True Grit, Inside Llewyn Davis, Hail Caesar, The Man Who Wasn't There. I think I said Fargo.
You did. No, I was.
Pardon me. Fargo is on HBO on the app that you have on your Xbox. I think you would really like that movie. It's very good. It's probably Probably my second or third favorite Coen Brothers movie. Like No Country for Me is like probably like number 5 or 6. I think Fargo is probably like 2 or 3. But they make a lot of great movies.
Having No Country that far down the disrespect.
But you ain't seen the rest of their movies, though. Their movies
I don't think I have to.
Inside Llewyn Davis is great. A Serious Man is probably my favorite. You know, they got a lot of great movies.
You probably got Busta Scruggs at number one.
Yeah, Busta Scruggs. They made Busta Scruggs. You ever watch that?
Not yet.
It'll happen one day.
I don't watch movies all day like you.
I don't watch movies all day either. I just find time to watch movies.
Well, I do.
All right, man.
Shit.
Chill out with that.
No, you chill out, bitch.
Yeah. So any foreign film directors you know? Who don't necessarily make foreign films with like different languages, but are just from different places. You ever watch any or listen to their stuff?
Do I listen or watch? Which
one? Watch. That's what I'm trying to say. Sorry.
No, I don't. But I like to listen to stuff about them. So, like Alfonso Cuarón. I like Yorgos Lanthimos, whatever his last name is.
You ain't seen The Favorite. I said it was.
I haven't, but it's on my list.
It might still be in theaters. It's so good.
I'm not doing that, but yeah, I like them. It's Denis Villeneuve, foreign. Would he be considered a foreign?
Who?
Denis Villeneuve.
Yeah, but I'm not huge on his movies though. I gotta finish rewatching Arrival. I did half of it and I didn't.
You need to finish rewatching that movie.
Yeah, I do.
Got one of the best twists in cinema history.
I think it's a pretty dumb twist. But I feel you.
You don't know the backstory, boy.
Okay. Yeah, man. He makes good movies too. A lot of good ones. Lars von Trier is a good one. Gaspar Noé, he's great. Thomas Alfredson, he made probably my favorite horror movie of the 21st century. I think he's great. You know, so.
I did want to add since this is the second season, we're going to shake things. I want to do a new segment. You know what I'm saying?
Go.
You ain't saying nothing.
I'm waiting on you.
Oh, it's called, I forgot the name. You talk for a second while I find it.
Peeps are looking for anything good to watch. Madeline is on Amazon Prime. It's a pretty amazing movie about the nature of performing. It's about who gets to tell which stories. It's about a young woman of color being raised by a white woman and what that means. What does it mean to have, you know, your story co-opted by an establishment that, you know, uses it for their own expression. It's a pretty powerful movie with one of the best endings of any movie last year. I think it's pretty great. Not a lot of people have seen it. Same with like Thunder Road, like I said earlier, but both of those are now on Amazon Prime, Thunder Road and Madeline's Madeline. Both great pictures. But if you don't want to see that, because probably only people like me want to see movies like that, you should probably check out
Kind of stupid to appreciate that movie?
Huh?
What you trying to say? We too stupid to appreciate that movie?
I mean, some movies I watch, I'm like, I love this. I'm going to tell other people to watch it. And then I realize I'm probably the only one who likes this. Or the only one of people I know who likes this, who would like something like this. I remember I was, who was that? What did I do? Oh, no. I had a friend of mine. I had posted something about Anomalisa, which is an animated movie that I think is one of the most beautiful movies ever made. And I posted something about how much I love it. And then a girl hit me up and she was like, hey, I watched that movie you told about. I really liked it. I was like, really? I was like, that's surprising. You like pretty terrible movies.
So you're pulling holes off the strength of your knowledge of cinema.
I mean, I wasn't pulling her. She was already cool with me. She just hit me up. I was like, hey, I like that movie that you recommended. And I was like, okay, let's try this other movie. And she was like, I don't like that shit at all. And I was like, well, hey, they can't all be winners, you know?
I found a name.
What is it?
I would like to introduce to the pod No Cap Hour. We keep the take sizzling over here. And that's where we come out with our, I guess you could say.
Maybe listen to that. It's a flagrant too. You get using that rhetoric. That
flagrant too.
What you talking about? You like flagrant too.
I ain't listening much, so fuck Andrew Schultz and Akash and Cass.
You been watching Views from the Sis?
No, you're not going to get me off my point.
You been watching Views from the Sis, though?
Like I was saying.
I'm asking. Have you not?
No, nigga.
I thought you liked that inside comedy in his channel now.
I watched that little shit.
Yo, Schultz gonna retweet you and have you out here getting roasted on Twitter.
Schultz on the Joe Rogan podcast and swear he done made it.
Oh, is he really?
Yeah, he's on the latest episode.
Oh, that's cool. I'm gonna listen to some clips.
Bro, they put the clips on Twitter and he was like, he was sending like, Netflix is dead, bro. And Rogan like, nah, what the fuck are you talking about? Like, it was...
I listened to a podcast weeks ago. He been saying that a lot of places. He's like, Netflix dead. The networks are dead. It's all about YouTube. I'm like, chill out, bro.
And he's so hurt, bro. He's
you can tell he hurt, though.
He said Netflix is losing. It's like he was from the crowd when he was talking about it, bro. Like, I was so scared. And Joe was like, nah, man. I don't know what you're talking about, bro. He said, get this nigga off my shit.
And Joe really said that I'm going to be cracking up, bro. He was like, hey, Netflix dead, bro. These networks are going to fold. He's like, nah, bro. I'm a nah.
Bro, that's how he was talking. He was like, he said Netflix is making like 100 million. And Schultz was like, Netflix is like in $10 billion in debt and stuff like that. And I was like,
he's right. They are in debt. There are a lot of
debt. He said, wait, billions?
I think so.
Yeah, I don't know. But cool. I don't got the numbers in front of me, so whatever. And Roman like but they'd be like bringing in like hundreds of millions of dollars and all that kind of stuff. And it was like he was waiting for this opportunity to get on a platform like Joe Rogan and to trash Netflix. He was impassioned, like he was in a crowd, bro, for real.
I mean, he's been doing it in a lot of podcasts. He's been saying that same thing a lot of different places.
About how, like, there's no middleman no more and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, like, how we're the artist and we're the stuff. And every time he says that, I think, like, that's, like, I agree with him in a large degree. But I also think, like, the stuff he's putting out is just, like, lesser degrees of what's been putting out on, like, television and stuff.
Yeah!
My biggest problem, because I watched some of the Views from the Sis, and I was like, this is funny. But he's not saying nothing that, like, other people haven't said.
He's not flagrant. And I watched Bill Burr.
He said some stuff that I'm like, I wouldn't have made that joke. Like, sometimes he makes jokes. I'm like, I get why they don't want to work with you. Like, those jokes I wouldn't let on my platform either.
Which one are you talking about? You talking about the tranny one?
The tranny, like, I saw that in the trailer, and I was like, that's in bad taste. Like, don't do that.
And it's stupid, because he was like, it's just shortening the word. No, it was a slur to them.
He made one joke on the first part of it, or, like, maybe second part. I don't know. I saw one clip online and on the Views from the Sis, and I watched it and I was laughing, and then he said something, I was just like, I don't know about this, bro. And then I looked in the comments, it was like, man, Schultz really out here challenging the audience. But I'm like, nah, he's just kind of like, and I'm just thinking, I'm like, Gerard Carmichael challenges the audience. Like, Schultz is just saying shit that's, like, going to get a rise out of people.
And bro, you know when something's not authentic and genuine and people fishing. And that's what I'm saying. Like, it's not enough to just be like, I'm going to just say some wild shit. It's like, are you really doing it as a thought? Or are you just like, I want to do it because I know it's going to make people upset? It's like, and then at that point, it's like, I can see where I threw your shit. And I'm not finna, I'm not even like some of the stuff is funny. But then it's like, yeah, this ain't even funny. It ain't hurtful to me, but it's just like, I know you trying. You trying too hard. Like, it's like I was on like a stand up kick last night, and I did go back to some Gerard stuff, and you can tell he genuinely just asking these questions, and they come off as tough, and it's just like, but you know, it's not. I don't think it's malice in his heart. Like, I don't think it's malice in Short's heart. I just think he's trying hard to be that person to be like, I'm gonna push it. It's like, you don't have to push it all the time. Like, Michael Shea does great stand up. And he has, like, an unconventional joke sometimes, and it's like, ooh, that's kind of tough. But it's like, I can see it, though. It's like, I know what you're trying to do, and it's not forced. It's not pushed. It's like, I came up with this joke out of earnest, and out of, like,
I don't know about that. Like, Schultz seems pretty sincere with his stuff. Part of his comedy persona is that kind of, like, loud, brash, I'm going to make this point.
And that's why I don't think it's genuine.
I mean, it's part of his persona. I mean, I don't know. I can't say whether it is or not. I don't think he believes, like, the training.
I don't think he's saying what I'm saying.
I feel you.
I'm not talking about him as a human being. I'm talking about in the joke itself. It doesn't feel like a genuine joke. It feels like something he sat down and, like, I need to make this funny because they say not to. And the other guys I named, a Michael Shea, a Gerard Carmichael, a Bill Burr, it comes off as, you know my heart, like, genuinely. I'm making this joke because I'm genuinely trying to figure out why things are this way. I like the whole training thing didn't make sense to me because it was like they didn't just shorten it to shorten it. And you know that. Like it's almost like it ain't offensive. It's just not good. It's not funny to me. It's like it's dumb almost. I don't think you put enough thought in that joke, is what I'm saying.
My thing is this. I don't want to keep bashing on the dude because I don't know him. He don't know me. But part of what I see when I watch his stuff, I'm like, this is funny. This is like well thought out, well performed. He's passionate. It's really good stuff. But like nothing he says here, I don't think can be said elsewhere by someone else. You know what I'm saying? And it's not even like the tranny thing. And like he says some stuff that maybe a little flagrant offensive. The way he speaks about it is like I think one, some of the jokes you say come off as like the type of stuff that like a fucking like alt-right dude would say, and like unironically. And I get you're saying it on the stage, but you're saying it to try to make a point. And I think his point he's making is like, this is like the training is just quicker. And I'm like that's an example of like, that's not a point to be made. Like, that's just something to say. Like, you're not saying anything like about an internal truth. And he always talks about like, it's all about the jokes, about the funny. It's not about the politicalness. And it's like, yeah, but what you're doing is you're specifically challenging the audience. So you're trying to be political. You're trying to get them to be upset and then come around to laugh. But what you're saying is not anything that's making them take a turn, have a realization. It's just about like you being a flagrant comedian. I don't know. It's something when I listen to him, I'm like, this is funny. This is good. Some of the stuff he needs to pull back on, you know, I get that. But something about it just feels so anonymous versus when I hear Gerard does a joke or when I hear like, Drew Michael, the guy who Gerard directed his stand-up special for HBO, which is amazing. You should watch it. Like when I hear Drew Michael does his jokes, he has a joke in there where he tells this really weird joke about wanting to smash his mom, but then he turns it around to be like, aren't you weird because you sat here and listened to a guy talk about smashing his mom? You're the fucking weirdo. I'm just the guy who thought about it. You the one who were interested in it. You know what I'm saying? And it's really interesting idea there. But it's something about the way Schultz puts his jokes out. I'm just like, these kind of points I've seen made better elsewhere, you know, or just haven't been made at all because they don't need to be. That's kind of my deal with Schultz. And also, like, him on Flagrant 2 is kind of annoying. He's funny. I listen to Flagrant 2, I'm like, it's funny, but they just really excited about each other. I don't know. Something about it's off-putting. And Brilliant Idiots, I just don't listen to because I don't care about the stuff they talk about. You know what I mean? Like, I don't care about Cardi being in them. Like,
they don't just talk about that.
Yeah, but they talk about, like, current event stuff. And after a while, I'm just like, yeah, I don't keep up with Yes Jules. I don't know. I just heard about it today because they were talking about on Brilliant Idiots. And then Joe Budden talked about it. And then some black women on BET talked about it, and I was just like, oh, I wonder what happened with her. But it's not something I keep up with, so I just don't. A lot of that stuff doesn't matter to me.
Well, what would you prefer them talk about?
Who, Bree and Idiots? I don't know. I mean, I like when they talk about political stuff. I like when they have a person on and they have a conversation with them about their work and their stuff. I like when they talk about, like, what they want to do. I don't know.
I don't like to hear them talk about what they want to do, because I don't like, I think they both, like, or, I don't want to hear your work. I don't know. It just comes off a certain way to me.
Yeah. I mean, my biggest problem with, like, current event podcasts is that they have a shelf life, and then, like, in a year, you can't go back and listen because it's just them talking about stuff that happened a year ago. It's not, like, anything that you can re-listen to and be like, ah, that's funny, or, like, ah, I like this joke. It's just, like, it's kind of just the, it's old news. It's nothing really to listen to.
And that's why I like Joe Budden, because, like, a lot of their stuff is current events, but they'll throw in a bunch of, like, off-base stuff where it's just them talking about, like, stuff that they know. And I love that. And, like, and they'll also get off script a lot, or get off topic a lot. And they'll talk about, like, hip-hop or something, like, old stuff. And I'm just, like, I'm very interested in it. I love when they just banter more than when they talk about, like, something happening in the news. I don't really care about that kind of stuff, unless it's something I care about. Mm-hmm. But, like, it was a segment from a really old episode, like a year and a half ago, and it's on that YouTube page, and it was like top 10 rappers of all time, and I love that, and I love stuff like that, and I don't really hear Brilliant Idiot do that kind of stuff, but like, it's just kind of like, it ain't about nothing, it ain't about a current event, it's just about like, what they care about, and everybody in that room love hip-hop, so like, they, and it starts from like, Mace versus Cameron, they just kind of go into like top 10, and then they had like a whole 20-minute segment on that, and like, top 15 and all that kind of stuff, because like Maul kept saying like everybody was in his top 20, and they made a joke about that. It was just like I love how they get off topic. So that's really why I appreciate the Joe Budden podcast. It's just it's a lot of the great qualities I used to get from Brilliant Idiots, but it's also in their way, and they bring their own stuff to it. And like I love like the small things, like how they incorporate music into the podcast and like drops and things like that. And then at the end, they'll do a sleeper pick, and I love those because I find so many hidden gems from them. And also, like, I love when they have guests, and they don't have guests often, but I love, like, when they had Justice on. I think he's, like, a producer. He worked with Black on his album, and they had Chance the Rapper episode, and even a Pusha T episode. You know, I don't fuck with Pusha T, but I like that episode because I just, like, it's different. You know, I don't hear him talk much, and he talked about the Drake stuff, so I was like, I'll listen to that. And they talked about, and they had Chance on one, and they go on the road, which the Brilliant Idiots don't do anymore, and I hate that because I love their road shows. But like Joe Budden and them will go on the road, and they'll put the whole thing up, or at least a lot of it, up online, and you see how that is, and they'll play this road game like a truth to truth with the audience. I just love what they're doing. I love their podcast, and they on Spotify. I just think that's dope because I got Spotify and I love that. So it's just it's a lot of reasons why they're the number one podcast to me right now. And they're really the only one I listen to on a consistent basis, kind of like how I did with Brilliant Idiots a couple years ago.
I think I would like that more if I like really valued their opinions on like hip hop and music and, you know, society in general. But I kind of don't. So like listen to them is like listen to like people I don't agree with or don't think have good ideas. Just talk about their ideas. Which I'm not saying you're wrong or anybody's wrong with. It's just like, that's from me personally.
But I think that's weird because you'll listen to Charlamagne talk about hip hop before Joe, and that's just weird to me. But you know.
I don't like hearing Charlamagne talk about hip hop at all, especially nowadays.
But you have for years, so I just don't really.
Yeah, but now I just like. I don't really watch. I don't like listening to people's opinions on things that aren't. You know, I don't like listening to people who have opinions on things who aren't super knowledgeable about it. About the 360 of the issue, which is why I don't watch a lot of YouTube videos on like movies I like anymore, like I used to when I was younger. Because it's just like at a certain point, you like either I know what you're gonna say, or you're gonna say something that's like really unresearched or just flat out wrong about the history or something. Like YMS is one of my favorite YouTube channels because he's funny, but he made a video on Old Boy, which I agree is a very bad movie, like the remake. And I was, because I love the original. I think the remake's terrible. And And he's, and, you know, I was dreading that because I like, I know what he's going to do is make a lot of points about like Spike Lee and why he made that movie and why Spike Lee isn't a good filmmaker at all to begin with. And then you would have a lot of people in the comments saying stuff like, yeah, Spike Lee's trash. And this is the main example of why. And I think that's a terrible Spike Lee movie, but I realized I don't want to watch this because I don't want to deal with having to see people be wrong about Spike Lee. So I'm just not going to watch any of it, even though I agree with the point he's making about this being a bad movie. You know, it's kind of like that.
Weird flex, okay.
Huh?
I said weird flex, but okay.
All right, well, you no cap thing?
No cap hour, you know. That's where I bring.
Full hour, don't worry.
Huh?
Go ahead.
So I bring in an unpopular opinion, and you can do this also. You ain't got to do it today, but if you ever want to, you don't have to. I don't care. But it's where I bring in an unpopular opinion, and then we talk about it and make and see if it's cap or no cap.
Well, then go ahead.
All right, mine for this week is this. No cap. The Dark Knight is a top five movie of all time.
No.
You meant to say that's cap.
That is very cap. That's all cap.
I think that's... I don't know. I don't... I just bring the question. I don't necessarily, you know, agree or disagree. I just, you know, I just bring it in. But why do you think that's cap?
Well, I think even if you had said American movies, that would give it more weight. And I don't agree with that. But I think when you say movies, you're talking about the wide... You said top five movies all time. Not that you, or just the question. Top five movies all time means over the entire history of films across the world, it's top five of all time. I don't agree at all. It's pretty great, and I love watching it, and I've seen it multiple times, but top five of all time is ludicrous. And I would say that about very few movies. And I'm, you know, I'm just more conscious about where American movies stand in terms of precedence and where, and, you know, place in the world. And also, I think, I don't even think that's the best Nolan movie. I would put Inception and Dunkirk over that movie. You know, people might disagree, but I think that's the case. I think Heath Ledger gives it one of the best performances by an American actor ever. I'll give you that. But I think as a whole, I wouldn't put that movie.
Why are you qualifying it with American? So you watch three foreign films and you think you know something about foreign movies?
No. I'm not saying that. What I had, I checked that on myself because I used to all the time be like, oh, this is a great, this is one of the best movies ever. I used to talk about Do the Right Thing. I say this is one of the best movies ever, but now I say like this is one of the best American films ever made, right? Because I think that's important to note because I haven't seen all the foreign language films. I don't really have a context for everything that they've made. And I don't know their history as well as America.
It'll never be as good as American films. You know that.
Hey, that's your POV. So my
point. You know we make the best stuff. Don't care.
So my point is that because I don't know these things, for me they just jump into the water and say like this is the best period. It's really ignorant of me because I've seen so few of like world cinema, and then that's me just projecting onto them saying like, yeah, I get y'all make y'all own stuff, but it ain't better than this. So I just try to be more conscious of saying American films. Yeah, but like out of the foreign films I've watched and the ones that I truly, truly love, I don't think Dark Knight touches the best of the foreign language films that I've seen. And I think also you have to think about the aims of the movie, the point of view of where it's trying to come from. Like a movie like Eden, like the French movie that was made in like 2014, it's weirdly paced, and because it's made in a culture that doesn't directly prioritize pacing and narrative, it's a movie that kind of meanders throughout like the 2 hours of the movie, and you kind of end up at the end, and you're like, oh shoot, you know, I just watched a life happen. And you know, the aim of that movie is very different from The Dark Knight, so I can't really compare them in on the sense of like this one's better, because what Eden is doing, it does extremely well. If I judged The Dark Knight versus what Eden is trying to do, Dark Knight really fails because it doesn't really have that kind of sense of place based on like living in the space. But if I wanted to judge Eden versus what The Dark Knight does, which is like rigorous plotting, very identifiable characters and like very strong iconic performances, Eden doesn't have that at all. So it's a failure on that level. And you have to think about where that stands in those 2 points. I think if you look at what The Dark Knight is trying to do and put it versus other movies that are trying to do similar things, I don't think The Dark Knight is the most successful version of that movie. I don't think it's a top 10 successful version of that movie. So that's where I come from with it. I would say, like, if you're looking at The Dark Knight, I would say Inception's better, and it does similar things. In terms of movies that do similar things, oh, like Inception, Dunkirk, which are two other Nolan movies that I think are pretty great and better than The Dark Knight. I would say Gone Girl. I would say Seven. I would say Alien. I would say, man, I'm losing all track of my mind. Alien. I would say Heat. I would say, man, I would say Collateral. Yeah, I wouldn't say Collateral. I'll take Collateral out. I'll say not Drive. I can't think of what the movie is. Baby Driver. I would say probably Logan. Yeah. Logan probably wasn't what with Dark Knight, I'd say. Yeah, maybe. Nah, I put Logan a little bit lower. But all that to say is I think there are movies that do what Dark Knight does better than what The Dark Knight does. Does them. Hardy.
All right. To keep it fair, if I was to make an argument for the no cap side, it would be because it has one of the best performances of all time, and none of those other movies you named has one of those performances. It is directed by one of the best directors of all time, and a lot of those movies aren't that you named.
They are. Most of them are.
Nah, not really. It's a better score, I think.
No. I mean, yeah. I don't like the score that much. I think the score in the next movie, Batman movie is better. Can
I talk? I gave you minutes.
All right, Nate, talk then.
Shit.
Yeah, you always want to argue. Go.
I think it's just a better, well-made film. If I was doing a no-cap side, I think it's just a better, well-made film that could actually be considered great films or other great films, and those other ones are never considered that. Except like Inception.
And Dunkirk.
Yeah. And I think this thing that happens with a lot of industries, especially entertainment, the movie has to be deemed as serious, I guess, in order to be taken seriously. And usually, typically, if it's about made up, you know, characters, especially like comic book characters, things of that nature, it's not taken seriously unless it's out of the park good.
And who said this?
Did I say you said it?
I said who said this?
I didn't say people said it. I'm talking about it's more of an idea. It ain't just said like I don't like it because.
But where did you get this idea from?
Are you gonna let me finish my point? I didn't interrupt you.
No. I'm just asking about.
Like, I don't want you to ask till I'm done.
How did you gather this opinion? That's all I want you
to ask until I'm done.
Fine, finish. No, ask the question.
Well, shut up.
Finish.
Like I was saying, a lot of movies to be deemed great or all-time great or like albums, anything like that, they usually have to be taken seriously in terms of, you know, what they're talking about and all that kind of stuff beyond how they're made. And if they're just technically great, like subject matter comes into a lot of music. It's a lot of reason why a lot of people don't take Drake seriously in the conversation like best of all time, because, you know, a lot of them will say he don't have that many classes or he don't have enough. And then the next point will be like, you know, did he or didn't he write his music and all that kind of stuff. And then like they usually finish it with he never talks about anything, or at least that was the conversation a few years ago. Like he doesn't really talk about serious matters, because I remember when he came out with that line about on 6 p.m. in New York when you're like, oh, maybe we should try to help somebody and be somebody instead of being somebody who see the news and everybody tweet about it, then they RIP about it. And then we just move on or whatever. And like, I just had to get my piece about it. And people were like, we need to hear more. Like a lot of reason why people don't consider Drake one of the best, because they don't hear that side from him, much like a Kendrick does, like to Pimp or something like that. To where like he's talking about like very serious issues. A Cole do a lot, and they say that Drake doesn't really do that. And I think there are subtle ways of doing things if you are going to do them. And also, I think art doesn't necessarily need that layer of, I guess, seriousness or like range and topic. Because I would say Drake pretty much stays on his on his few topics that he knows and or that he's comfortable with. And I would never ask of him any more than what he's comfortable with. I don't mean in terms of growth of music, but in terms of what he's talking about, because I would hate for somebody to talk about something and they don't really know what they're talking about, like a Kanye. And just because he's, you know, talking about stuff that is deemed serious to our community and things like that, he could say what he has said about that kind of stuff. And then I wish, and I can kind of say that I think we all wish he didn't talk about that stuff anymore. So it doesn't always do good for an artist to speak on things, especially when they don't know. So I think that that's not needed. But and to go back to The Dark Knight, I think a lot of reason why people would never really consider it up there, you know, besides comic book fans and people like that, I think because it's based on a comic book character, a very famous one, but one nonetheless, I think people kind of look down on that. I don't think they see the seriousness of the topic as opposed to something else like a Godfather or something like that. And I think people really take that into consideration when they're trying to decide, like, okay, I'm going to put this up there with the Pantheon greats. And they're like, well, I can't, even though he gave a Pantheon great performance and it was directed by a Pantheon great and Christopher Nolan. You can't put it up there because what it's talking about. And the same thing with Drake. Like, he doesn't talk about serious issues enough for us to really consider him one of the Pantheon greats. And I think that it does a disservice to entertainment in all forms, because entertainment in its entity or in what it is for is to entertain. Now, you can have a message, you can preach a message, you can practice a message, and you can convey a message. But that does not mean that that is what you need to do in every single piece of entertainment. You go to different people for different things. But if it's still great, you cannot exclude it. And that's why I will never exclude Drake from that conversation, because he might not talk about police brutality, he might not talk about poverty, and he might not talk about systemic oppression as much as a Cole or a Kendrick or someone like that, or, a Tupac or, you know, anybody like that. And Dark Knight might be a comic book movie at its core, but when something is made well and it's efficient and it's effective, like Drake's music is, like Dark Knight is, in its acting and its direction and its vision, to not just make the stereotypical comic book movie, but something that raises the bar for what a comic book movie can be. It can still be a cinema classic and a masterpiece. I think one could put it in that conversation, even if you don't think it's top five or top 10 or whatever. It has to be in the Pantheon greats because it is a better made film than a lot of other films who try to be great, but they aren't. And while it is a comic book movie, it didn't just slip up and be great. It didn't backwards walk into greatness. It was made great. It is a great film with performances. One in particular that will stand the test of time. It's why it's got a posthumous Oscar award, if that means anything to you. So, yes, Dark Knight can be one of the top five movies, if you believe it is, because it should not be deferred because of its stance as a quote-unquote comic book film. Like, Drake should not be deferred because he quote-unquote talks about women all the time. Not saying you made that claim, I'm just making that point. So yeah. If I was to say no cap, that would be the reasons why. It's one of the better made films with one of the better made performances with one of the better made directors. And just because it's a comic book movie, it should not be deferred or deterred from that conversation, if I was to say no cap to that.
Okay. Where do you think that idea of like genre movies or superhero movies not getting the credit they deserve because of what they're about? Where'd you get that? Where do you think you got that idea from?
I think more than anything, it came from fatigue. I think people just really got tired of that genre. And I also think people consider those movies as nerd movies. Like, and for some reason, like, you know, Star Wars and those kind of movies will kind of like be to the side of that conversation. But if it's a comic book, it isn't, you know, it's not deemed as quality.
But who are you talking about when you talk about?
I'm talking about a segment of the population that kind of like thinks like you do. Like, you know how you talk, like, you'd be like, I don't even want to see another one. It's kind of like that. It's like, you don't even want to see the movie. Even it could be the best comic book movie ever, but you don't want to see it because of the stigma of comic book movies, and maybe you're tired of them. I don't know your reasoning, but it's like, it's almost as if you've given up hope that it's going to be good based on what you've already seen and what you've heard, and that it's, you also know it's a comic book movie. But if you just took that Marvel out of it, you might could see it completely different, or DC or whatever. But because of the stigma of comic book movies, you are already inclined to believe it will be less than, and that is going to hinder movies like Dark Knight and Logan, which are better made movies, but they will be directly hindered because they are quote-unquote comic book movies, and a lot of people who think like you will be like, that's not a serious enough movie for me to take seriously when we talk about the best movies.
Okay, so I see that kind of rhetoric thrown around a lot about from a lot of smart people who talk about how like either frivolous things or like genre stuff don't typically get the kind of critical love or awards love more often than like stuff that's a bit more heady and a bit more down to earth. And my problem with that rhetoric is if you look at the history of movies or even albums, there's a certain intersection between like sophistication and accessibility. Because here's the thing, movies like Back to the Future, the Ghostbusters, the OG Star Wars, Alien, Taxi Driver, I don't know, what's of the 90s? The Matrix. These movies are more known and more popular and more revered, Blade Runner, than most dramas that came out at that time, and are more remembered as well, even if they aren't as good as those dramas. Because they have a certain amount of accessibility that comes with the fact that they're about this kind of otherworldly thing, whether it be like action or sci-fi or superheroes, it allows them, people to kind of address them on kind of a general level, not have to think too much about them when they come in contact with them. And that's going to happen with The Dark Knight. So The Dark Knight is going to be remembered long, long after a movie like Rain Room, right? In 200 years, people are going to talk about how good The Dark Knight is if the world is still here. And people will probably have forgotten or about Green Room and not, or haven't thought about it. Even more, they'll probably remember The Dark Knight. I mean, there's more talk now of how good The Dark Knight is than there ever is going to be talk about Social Network being as good. Even though I argue The Social Network is like 10 times the movie The Dark Knight is. And that's because of what it's about. And it's because of, you know, it's got that accessibility thing on the front of it. Like, it's an action movie first, and then people can have fun with the action. And the same thing with music as well. So if anybody who's like drinking in those convos because he doesn't talk about real world issues, they're living in the present. And what they need to realize is that people like Pac and people like Biggie, they did not make heady music. They made music that was really well done and mixed well with like an accessible sound. Because if you look at it, people like the Weathermen were way more lyrical, way more like hip hop heady type. AZ, who used to work with Nas all the time, do make hip hop classics, and people do not remember him or talk about him. Members of the Wu-Tang Clan make very specific boom bap hip hop records that people revered and called masterpieces, and nobody remembers their records unless you're a super hip hop head. So, I'm telling you, in 100 years, nobody's gonna remember Kendrick Lamar. The song, they're gonna remember Damn, and they won't remember T-Pab at all. They're gonna remember.
I don't believe that.
Huh?
I don't believe that at all.
I mean, yeah, it'll be in the annals because it's so popular, and it's because it's so well done, people are probably going to, you know, classify it as something. But if you talk about the layman, most people, the kind of people who don't listen to hip-hop now but know who Tupac and Biggie are and know their songs, are the kind of people in, like, 20, 40 years, well, let's say 20 years after Kendrick Lamar dies, are probably going to be like, yeah, I know Bitch Don't Kill My Vibe, I know Humble, but Drake's music is going to live way longer and way farther, and people are going to vibe with that way more. There's a reason why people don't really think about Pink Floyd unless you're a rock fan. Pink Floyd's music is amazing, but they don't make music that you can play on the radio or that you can easily remember to get stuck in your head. They make long instrumental tracks, long 10-minute songs with like weird ethereal lyrics, and they were super popular in their time. They sold millions of records. They are not nearly as remembered as Aerosmith. You know what I'm saying? Even though Aerosmith is objectively a worse instrument, like a worse band of musicians. You know, you could make, that's like pretty obvious when you listen to their music. So that's my point I'm making on that. So no matter what I may think about The Dark Knight not being top 10, it's going to be in the top 10 best movies of all time for way more people in like for a much longer time than a movie like The Social Network or Revolutionary Road or Closer. You know what I'm saying? Like, there are more people now who revere and talk about The Empire Strikes Back, second Star Wars movie, than ever talk about, you know, something like The Godfather. You know, there are kids now who haven't even seen The Godfather, who are just aware that it exists. But I bet you they've seen that. I bet you they've seen Luke Skywalker fight Darth Vader. Like, I bet you they've seen that. I bet you they've seen Marty McFly go back in time in that DeLorean. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's that kind of barrier of entry, that kind of like accessible nature of like, I can just watch this. It's not as heavy and it's not a drama. So I see more like people talk about that now. People talk like, you know, genre movies like The Conjuring or movies like It, they don't get love at the Oscars and stuff because people don't take them seriously. And I'm thinking like, you idiots, like, shut up. Like, nobody's going to remember Bohemian Rhapsody. Well, probably will. Never mind. Nobody's going to remember like The Favorite. They're going to be remembering like Star Wars. They're going to be like Infinity War is going to have much longer life than any movie that was nominated for an Oscar this year. And that's sad, but that's just true. Right. I don't think Infinity War is better than The Favorite. I don't think Infinity War is better than Black Klansman. But it's going to have a longer life and it's going to live more. And it's going to be the one that people look back on as a classic. The Conjuring, It, those movies are going to be remembered as like, I remember seeing that when I was 12, or I remember seeing that when I was 20 years old, and it changed my life. It's like one of the greatest horror movies of all time. I don't think neither one of those are really good horror movies. I think they're fine, right? I think if you want to look at a great horror movie, like Hereditary is a much better horror movie. It's not going to be remembered nearly as well as It or Conjuring, because those movies were extremely well made, made money, and they weren't so difficult to watch that you couldn't just watch them on a weekday. You know what I'm saying? And that's what it is. It's an intersection between smart, well-done like content and a sense of accessibility through the medium that it's being told in. You know what I'm saying? So, like, it'd be much easier probably for me to get more people to watch something like Dark Phoenix, which might even be a bad movie, than it would be to get people to watch Thunder Road, which is an amazing movie. Because it's a drama about like a cop in a small southern town, you know. It's like people would hear that and be like, "That sounds lame, boring. I could just go watch like Friends or something." You know, you could say like you could even say, "Think of, okay, what's a drama you like, Nate? What's a show that you like that's like a hardcore drama? Like it's not really funny." Yeah. You know?
A show that I like that's a hardcore drama.
Yeah. I watch Mad Men or Home Catch Farley. Mad Men isn't like it's funny, like haha, they said some jokes, like or they made a crack, a smart like remark, but it's not a comedy, like a show like that.
I don't watch it anymore, but I guess at the time The Walking Dead.
Okay. And then if I like think about a show like Blackish, right? Okay, let's go Blackish. I think in like 20 years time after The Walking Dead and Blackish have both ended, if I told you that's weird, because The Walking Dead is a genre show. So people would be like, I want to see them fight zombies. They probably want to see that more. I was thinking more real world stuff, but that's fine. If like in 10, 15 years, I try to get like a person, like a new friend of mine was like, I have two shows to choose between. I can watch Friends or I can watch Home Catch Fire. And I'd be like, Home Catch Fire is amazing. It's about computers in the 80s. And it's about like the nature of discovery and like the connectedness of, you know, working partners and all these things. And then there's Friends, which is like a fun show. It's funny. It's not really about anything. It's just about a bunch of friends doing stuff. But it's, you know, it's light and it's easy to watch. I bet you 9 times out of 10, that person's gonna be like, I'm going to watch Friends because it's less emotional investment and I don't really have to, you know, put so much into it. And that's going to happen with all art and all movies across time. There's a reason why Madonna is one of the most famous pop stars ever. She didn't make music that was too difficult to understand. She made it good enough. She made really great pop music that was also pretty accessible for most people to just kind of listen to and not really think about too much. And I think Drake's music is amazing. I think if you want to invest time into what he's saying and what he's doing and like the kind of music he's making, you will get a lot out of it. But also, if you just want to be like, I just want to listen to Hotline Bling and like dance a little bit, you can do that and still get a lot out of that song. That's why I think that song is going to live far longer than like DNA by Kendrick Lamar. You know what I'm saying? That's my point. It's like Dark Knight versus Revolutionary Road or, you know, The Social Network.
I think you missed my point.
Well, that's my point. I wasn't defeating your point. I was just trying to, I think what you were saying about the thing about it being a superhero movie, I see a lot of that said about a lot of other smart people. And I'm always like, y'all are looking in too far, y'all are too in the present. In like 20 years time, that movie you say and is not getting respect now is going to be the thing that everybody wants to listen to or watch or reference, because nobody's going to remember that fucking, nobody's going to remember Earl's album, some rap songs, even though it's a great album, because it's just so weird and people have to, you know, you have to invest time in to really get into. But if you don't want to, you can just.
But for people that matter, that song's going to age way more than something else. And that's my thing. I don't
matter. Who matters?
I'm about like
who buy tickets or who matter. People who drive culture.
I'm talking about people, like the people who.
If we're talking about the people who drive culture, the guys who are on like State of the Culture now, who are on Everyday Struggle, they grew up listening to Pac, Biggie, Eminem, Lauryn Hill. You know what I'm saying? They're not out here throwing out references like, oh yeah, I loved LP in the 90s. No, they love Run the Jewels LP. You know what I'm saying? Nobody was like, I love Killer Mike before he got with Run the Jewels. I love Killer Mike as a solo artist when he wasn't doing Outkast songs. Nobody listens to album by Killer Mike from 2003 to 2008 because nobody listened to Killer Mike then. He was an underground rapper that nobody cared about. And that's what people don't understand. It's like, you look at the Scotty Beams, you look at the Jinxes of the world, they sound smart, and they're like, oh, I'm really into, like, Vince Staples and shit. Now.
Oh, they don't. But,
yeah, I mean, you may, you know, you depend, but, like, they out here talking about, like, oh, I'm into indie rap. I'm not into, like, Drake, because Drake makes, like, music that isn't deep and stuff. And I'm like, you fucking child, you grew up listening to Cannabis. You grew up listening to popular rappers, Cam'ron, 50 Cent. Like, you weren't out here digging for, you know, fucking Mad Villainy or MF Doom, you know what I'm saying? Like, they were doing the same stuff everybody else is. So in 20 years' time, the people who are writing about music, that's why I always talk about, like, in 30 years, For Your Eyes Only is going to be written about as, like, the greatest rap album of all time. Because the people who are, like, now who are like, yeah, it's kind of boring, those kids are going to be like, oh, no, I grew up listening to, like, okay, the people who say right now, like, J. Cole doesn't make music that, like, challenges stuff and it's kind of boring, the people who, like, fucking love J. Cole are going to write music later and they're going to be like, he's the greatest ever. And you're never going to have a record of him being boring ever. Because all the people who write about music are going to love J. Cole. In that same vein, all the people who are going to write about music in like the next 20, 30 years are going to be like, fuck it. Like, they're going to be like, what are you talking about? Views is like the greatest record of all time. Feel No Ways is a perfect pop song. You know what I'm saying? Like, nobody's going to be like, hey, he don't make real rap music. That's the kind of shit people say when they're like, you weren't listening to real rap music back in the day. Kind of people who listen to real rap music were 20-year-olds. Like, you were 12 and you listened to Pac and Biggie just like everybody else. And now you want to talk about, no, I'm in the underground rap. This stuff is too poppy. Niggas singing too much now. Like, no, because in 20 years, the people who were listening to fucking Juice WRLD now are going to be like, Juice WRLD is a genius hip hop artist. Like, that's the point. Like, that's what I don't think people understand. They're just too deep in the present. You know, Joe Budden, I bet you if you talk to Joe Budden, because even now on his show, he talks about like, trendy music on his show. It's not like he's bringing up like Benny the Butcher. I'm sure they have, but I'm not.
Yeah, they definitely brought him up.
Yeah, they brought up Benny the Butcher, right? I'm not saying that they're not down with Benny the Butcher, but they're not bringing up like Open Mike Eagle and like people like that on their show for like, this is the new hotness. What they bring in there is like stuff that's going to bounce and like kids are going to listen to. Like, that's what they're talking about. You know what I'm saying?
And that can be farther from the truth, though.
Every time I listen to their show, when they do that thing, when they bring up songs, it's like, this is like something I could have heard played. Like, this is something like DJ Academics would have recommended.
Listen to it.
Huh?
How many times have you heard the sleeper picks? Or like, have you listened to a whole episode?
I usually don't listen to the episode. I usually skip around. But I usually listen to the sleeper picks. So in the past couple of weeks, I've listened to like pretty much every episode. But I don't listen to the whole thing. I listen to like, this is a topic I want to hear. And I listen to the sleeper picks. And then it's like.
Well, you can't tell me what they don't talk about then.
I'm not saying they don't talk about it. I'm saying, like, the kind of stuff that they usually recommend is the stuff that most people will listen to. I'm just saying, like,
because I didn't know about Mareba until, like, I think that was the sleeper pick that this week. It was Sandstorm. I didn't know about that until Lindsay told me. And I didn't know about a lot of the rappers that, part.
Like Sandstorm is not a song that you wouldn't listen to.
No. Like, hold on. It's a song right? Fred the Godson, like, you have to really know rap to know who Fred the Godson is.
Because there's probably people hitting them up talking about this is a dope rapper.
No, it's not. It's called sleeper picks for a reason. All of them are older.
I'm not saying that they recommend them. Look, Nate, Academics knew about YMN Melly before anybody did. You know what I'm saying? But that doesn't make his sound not accessible. He has a very popular sound. Even before he gets hit big, he has a sound that could easily cross over. So what I'm saying is the music they end up recommending for people that I've heard is like, yeah, this is stuff that can be played on the radio. Y'all ain't recommending nothing that's like crazy out there. Like, y'all recommend the kind of stuff that anybody will listen to.
And you haven't heard enough to say that. And I'm telling you, a lot of music won't be on the radio because I've heard enough of it. I'm just saying that.
I mean, hey, like a song like Sandstorm, I could easily hear that playing on the radio. Like, that's a song that could get big real fast. Because that's a great song that's like...
That's the only song you're talking about. I mean, but tell me when Fred the Godson is going to be on the radio.
And I'm not going to argue with you. You watch Your Boy way more than I do. So you
know, and that's what I'm saying. I know that they put music on that won't be on the radio ever. And that's why it's called sleeper picks. And yes, sometimes they do have that like poppy music, but it ain't all the time.
I think you're misunderstanding what I'm saying. I'm not saying that it's music that's... All I was saying was the way people talk about stuff now, as in like people don't talk about it in the top five convo, people don't give it Oscars, people don't give it Emmys, people aren't talking about it because they think it's not worth or valuable. My thing is, what you're focused on is the momentary thing. And if you look at history, that the stuff that gets remembered and the stuff that gets passed down and the stuff that people write articles about and revere for decades and like generations to come is the most populist, is the perfect intersection between populist and extremely well made. Star Wars is nowhere near the best movie of the 70s. It's made 1977. It's really good. It has like a couple good performances, some really cool effects, and that's about it, right? It's a really good movie. There are people, every time I get a notification, every once in a while I get a notification with people, because I wrote a comment on the Oscars, because Annie Hall by Woody Allen won Best Picture over Star Wars. And I wrote them like, I'm glad the best film won, right? And then every once in a while I get a comment like, this nigga thinks that Annie Hall is better than Star Wars. I'm like, when the last time you watched Star Wars? It is not better than Annie Hall. You had not watched Annie Hall. Nobody remembers Annie Hall or talks about it because it's a small movie about a relationship.
Or, Ian, they don't think it's a better movie.
No, because I know what you're finna say. This is what I'm saying. The stuff that gets remembered is the stuff that has the perfect intersection between those two. A movie like Last Picture Show, a movie like The Conversation, a movie like Deer Hunter. These movies are amazing films that no one talks about today, but they talk about Star Wars still. But they still talk about Alien. They still talk about Rocky. Rocky is a good movie. Alien is a great movie. I'm not saying these movies don't deserve to be talked about. What I'm saying is, if you look at what's being said and what's being talked about, the gap between the dramas of the 70s and the sci-fi and horror and stuff of the 70s, that gap is huge. And the same thing with like Madonna in the 1980s versus like, I don't know, the craziest, most well-made experimental hip hop and stuff in the 80s. Like, that stuff just doesn't get the same traction. There's a reason why Tupac and Biggie were the biggest of their time. You know what I'm saying? There's a reason. Okay. There's a reason why Jay-Z became much bigger than Nas, because Nas's music never transitioned into like that super mainstream level. He was still making rappity rap. Jay-Z made songs that could be played like pop songs. He made H to the Izzo, right? Like, this is what I'm talking about. The stuff that's going to get remembered is going to be the Drakes of the world. It's going to be Damn by Kendrick Lamar. It's going to be remembered way longer than Good Kid or T-Pab. I mean, you know, J. Cole, 2014 40 Souls Drive, is going to be remembered longer than any of his other records. And that's just true.
And it's not because of anything popular. It's just because that's better music to a lot of people, including
myself. Because they're the most popular. That's really the only reason.
Oh, because it's better music to us.
It's more popular because people think it's better music. Yeah.
You can justify why that stuff won't last. And I'm telling you, the whole point of this conversation was to let you know that the reason that Dark Knight, even though it'll be on people's tongues a lot, but it'll never be considered one of those best to people like you, is only because it's a comic book movie and not because it's not well made. And I'm not backing off that point, because I don't believe that if it wasn't, I believe that if it didn't have that umbrella of comic book, you would really put it up there higher than you do.
That's not true at all.
And you don't, is because it's a comic book movie.
That's not true at all. Spider-Man 2, I think, is the second best movie ever made. It's number two on my list. What are you talking about?
No, you'll pick and choose a few. All of them do, but you won't put the ones that really should be.
All right. Look, I'm not even going to fault you for this, but because you probably just don't know. if you go to the IMDb list of the highest rated movies of all time, The Dark Knight is the highest rated movie of all time on IMDb.
And you say yourself,
listen to what I'm saying. If what you're saying is the people like me, the fucking movie nerds who like, oh, I watch foreign films and shit, they're the ones who are going to be like, we don't count The Dark Knight. Those people have literally said The Dark Knight is the best movie of all time. So if you go to any movie website where there's, if you go to any movie website where there's amateur reviews or amateur star ratings, The Dark Knight is one of the highest rated on every single one of those sites. Where you go to Letterboxd, where you go to IMDb, any of this stuff.
Go to any top 10 list, Godfather and all of them are on there, and Dark Knight is not.
That's so, AFI. That's
history. I don't know what you're talking about.
That's it. What you're thinking about is AFI list. That's a historical list.
I'm not talking about one list. I'm talking about all of them. You will never see that on there unless you go to some Screen Junkies video, because they all nerds.
Do the right thing. Just do the right thing. And Pulp Fiction are like number 89 and 90 on the AFI list. They just got put on. No, listen to what I'm saying. They just got put on like 3-4 years ago. The point I'm making is those movies take into account time and like cultural relevance. So if you don't believe in 40 years that The Dark Knight isn't going to be on those lists, you're crazy. It's only because it's just 10 years old. Of course they're not going to put that movie, those movies on their list. But if you talk to any person who is alive now who are like seriously reviewing movies or like watch a lot of movies, most of them will say The Dark Knight is one of the best movies of the 21st century.
Easy. So ask you a question. Is No Country for Old Men on that list?
No, because it's too early.
I don't believe that, but I ain't seen it, so I don't know. Because I'm about to say, it ain't no way that can be, like, because that's not old at all. That's, what, 12 years? And I'm sure that's on that list, so I'm just like...
So Sight and Sound did a list, the I don't know, like the 100 best movies of the 21st century, which was voted on by producers, directors, actors, and all these things, right? The Dark Knight is like top 20 on that list. The top 10 is like, the number one on that list is like Mulholland Drive. Number two is like In the Mood for Love, which is a Chinese movie. The 25th Hour by Spike Lee is on that list. It's like 34. There Will Be Blood is like 14 on that list. No Country for Old Men, I think it's top 10 on that list. If you, I'm not arguing with you. I think The Dark Knight is top 20. So if you don't think both of those movies aren't going to be on like the big lists that are like when you look at the list and you say like Godfather, 2001 A Space Odyssey, Raging Bull, Citizen Kane, those lists have been around for like a long time, and those are lists based on precedence, history, and influence. In 20 to 50, like in 30 to 50 years, The Dark Knight, No Country for Old Men, all those kinds of movies that you're referencing now are definitely going to be on that list. And they're going to be on that list a lot faster and a lot quicker than anything. I promise you The Social Network is not going to be on that list. On that Sight and Sound, on the 21st century list, listen to what I'm saying. The Social Network is on that list. It is number like 60-something on that top 100 of the 21st century. The Dark Knight is in the top 20. There Will Be Blood, I mean, No Country is like top 10. Inception is on that list, and it's in like the 40s. So the point I'm making is people watch these movies, and the reason why these movies are going to be on those lists is because people have watched them and they remember them. A movie like Thunder Road, no matter how good it is, nobody has seen it. So it's never going to make that list. It has to be seen to be on those lists. And those movies, and the more it's seen, the more likely it's going to be on that list, no matter how good it is. So, I mean, and Dark Knight's very good, so it's probably going to get on that list. It's really good, and a lot of people have seen it. So that's a perfect mixture for it to be, like, on those lists in, like, time. But it's only been, like, 12 years. Why would it be on those lists in 12 years?
It needs to be appreciated now by people who know it will be one day and refuse
to. It is appreciated now.
It's not appreciated by people like you.
No, people like me, because I personally don't care for it. I mean, that's not true. Yeah, I like that movie a lot.
Exactly what you meant to say.
I'm saying, like, I personally don't put it that high on that list. What I'm saying is most people do. And if you ask most people, they will.
And my point is that you don't put it on that list because you don't like comic book movies. And that's not true at all. That's literally the only reason why.
That is not true at all, because I like other movies more. Like
maybe because they're not comic book movies, yes.
Spider-Man 1, 2, and 3 are like in my top 50 movies of all time. So you ain't gonna tell me I'm just here disliking comic book movies. I dislike MCU movies most of the time, but that doesn't mean I dislike comic book movies. I think those three Batman movies are great. I think Days of Future Past is great. I think Logan is great. I like Deadpool. I think The Avengers is great. So I think Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 is a great movie. So I don't, the reason I'm not putting it on that top 10, top 20 list, because for me, I just don't care for it as much as that. There are movies I would put in over that. That doesn't mean I don't love that movie.
Wait, my bad. What you say?
Don't worry about it. You ready to get off of this thing, man?
We done? Though you said you had a bunch of topics.
Nah, I don't. I mean, we were talking for hour 40. I'm kind of.
That's because we only started. And now, cause we no, actually, we ain't been talking for an hour 40.
We've been talking for like an hour 30 at least.
Where is your topics?
I ain't got no topics, bro. Let's wrap it up.
We need some structure.
You just gave a structure. That's the ending segment.
On the next one, we need to have some topics.
I don't want to talk about movies for like an hour on this.
I said topics.
I know, but let's not talk about movies that much. No.
Yeah, I'm gonna talk about what I want to talk about.
That's fine, bro. I just don't want to talk about.
I'm gonna talk about what I want to talk about.
But if you want to, talk about some, like, bring up some, like, let's talk about like Jonathan Demme's movies or something. Like, let's not talk about the movies that everybody else already has covered.
Like I said, you bring in topics or not, but I'm gonna talk about what I want to talk about. So
yeah, next time I'm gonna bring up. We're gonna have a deep dive on Rugrats. No, Powerpuff Girls. Let's do that.
You gay for having a deep dive on Powerpuff Girls?
How was that gay? It's a great show.
Cause you gay. It ain't got nothing to do with the show. You just gay.
Oh, how about Samurai Jack? I'm about to finish that show in a couple.
How about Pulp Fiction?
Yeah, I don't want to. I like that movie, but it's like everybody has talked about it to death. What is there to add to Pulp Fiction talk?
You kind of look contrarian. You don't like to talk about things everybody else talking about.
What do I have to add? Much smarter people have written and talked about that movie than me.
But it's only because, like, just to be different, like, you don't have a real.
No, I honestly believe that there's everything that can be said about Pulp Fiction has already been said.
Became the worst version of what I hate.
You don't agree? That movie's been talked about to death.
No, I agree. I just think you're trying very hard. You try hard to be different. You like Schultz now.
if you came here and you was like, yo, let's talk about Men in Black 2, I'd be like, let's go.
It's been a long time I got one for next time. We're going to talk about Atlanta. Deep dive.
Yeah, sure.
So you don't even want to do that one.
I mean, because I hadn't watched Atlanta in a while. Like, it's been a minute.
Rewatch it, and then we'll talk about it.
I don't want to rewatch it, bro. I got other stuff I'm watching.
I know. You just don't. You want to talk about what you want to talk about. Some foreign film.
You said that with such disdain.
It's all because, no, you know, I got disdain for it because it's like you think that make you special. Like, I like foreign film.
I don't think it makes me special at all.
You're not shit, literally. So it's just like, it bothers me because it's like, you really think that makes you special? And it's like, you're not.
That's great. Nah, bro. I don't think it makes me special. I don't know. I just watch a lot of stuff where people just talk about either like recent movies or just like movies that like Pulp Fiction and movies like The Dark Knight. And I just like get real tired of it. I just wish people would talk about more stuff that people haven't seen.
You said you have topics and then you didn't talk about them. So that's on you.
What you mad at me for? I just said, how does it affect you, bro?
You're bitching.
I'm not bitching. I'm just saying, like, I just don't want to talk about Pulp Fiction.
That's what do you want to talk about?
I was saying that, yeah, if you came in here talking about, like, Men in Black 2, I'd be like, I'd be down for that.
No, why do you keep saying nigga, what do you want to talk about?
I don't really want to talk about much at all.
I'm not talking about on this one. I'm talking about in the future.
In the future? I don't know what the future going to bring.
You so fucking stupid. You literally said at the beginning, you said, I got a couple topics. And then you talked about none of them.
I just don't feel the need. I mean, we covered pretty much everything I want to talk about.
Nigga, what you mean you don't feel the need?
No, we pretty much covered whatever I need to talk about.
All right, bro. Hey, I'm going to say it like this. Next time I see you, you're going to go on scrap because I'm tired of you.
This is what I'm going to do every time I come to Starville. I'm just going to pick up the DVD and then drop off another one. I'm gonna pick up Maze Runner and I'm gonna drop off one more. I'm like, hey, watch this, and then next time I'm gonna pick up that one, and then so on and so forth.
What if I don't watch them?
You probably will. It'll be
you're going to get Creed 2 on DVD.
Oh, cool.
I said R.
Oh, no. Me, no. You but got the first Creed. I just figured you would get that one.
I am, but you act like we in the same place, like we're going to watch it. You might want
I mean, you're the one who bought Baby Driver. I would like to... Like, to me, that don't make no sense. Like, if you wanted Baby Driver, I could have gave you Baby Driver to have for a minute to watch and stuff.
I don't want your Baby Driver because I'm not going to be here soon. I don't want to be around you.
Hey, I'm just saying, like, I don't need to buy Creed 2. If you got Creed 2, I'll just be like, if I want to see it and you got it, I'd just be like, hey, bro, I'm going to come up to Starkville. I'm going to take Baby Driver. I'm going to take Creed.
But I might not let you, so...
Or I'll be like, all right, let me borrow it for like Saturday night so I can watch it at Lindsay's, and then I'll bring it back Sunday before I leave.
I'm saying no.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it ain't that big a deal. Like, I don't need to buy it.
You buy it to support the movie.
If that's just, I'll just rent it on Amazon then.
Just like you bought Shutter Island, but it's on TV every night. See, you do it for the wife, but you don't do it for the black.
I bought Shutter Island like 2010 when I didn't know no better. I wouldn't have bought that movie. I don't like that movie that much.
You bought Lock and Key books. I'm not listening to you.
How else would I have read them, Nate? I can go. I went to the theater to see Creed.
It's just the fact that
I read Lock and Key without buying the book.
It's just the fact that you bought them. I just don't. It's just not good.
It makes no sense to me what you're saying right now. I want you to. I hope you listen back and be like, man, I sound crazy.
You just have terrible.
Why did I get on him about buying Lock and Key when that's literally the only way you can read something? But I can go to a theater to watch a movie.
It's more about what it is.
Crazy.
And the fact that you like
crazy.
You have terrible taste.
That's fine, bro.
I think that's really what it is.
That's fine.
It don't sound fine, accept it.
You can
shit.
You said it like I don't accept it. I said cool.
You don't accept it.
All right, bro. I got bad taste.
No. Oh, no, really say it, though.
I have bad taste.
No, say,
I have bad taste. You happy?
You still, it's not, I don't believe it. You're not really saying it.
Nate, I don't have to convince you of anything. What have you done for me?
That's true.
You be acting like you out here, like I owe you something.
You do. I'm the reason this goes. I'm the reason they listen.
You man said he the reason this goes.
You owe me for creative content, because you not.
What are you talking about? I brought the whole point about the hollow versus the dense.
And it was sucked, and I had to make it good.
You didn't even get that. Hey, look. I mean, hey, Luke, bro. I don't know what to tell you. You don't. You seem upset.
I'm not upset.
What's going on that ain't got to do with this podcast? You getting that on me. That's fine.
I do have a question though before we wrap up. What? I got a question.
What, bro?
Where does your love of white women stem from? Why are you laughing?
Oh, dude. I love all people. They're all great.
I don't believe it.
I don't know, bro. I don't know. Guess it's always been there. Who knows?
When did you start to dislike your own?
Well, like just like with the Wachowski sisters, I'm not doing this. So
they're brothers, first of all.
Yo, you need to chill out with that for real.
Just you cut it off don't mean you ain't one.
Chill, yo, Nate. Really, chill out.
No, Ian. Really, I'm telling you the truth.
All right, bro. I'm gonna let you have that. I'm gonna let you have that.
You have no choice.
I mean, yeah, I do.
I mean, yeah, you don't. So on the next one, what we got to look forward to?
I don't know, bro.
That's not very productive.
Cool.
If you don't want to be a current events podcast, you really need to start coming up with some topics. Otherwise, we're gonna talk about what's going on in the news. So
I just don't want to talk about movies that much anymore. That's all. Kind of the move here.
Well, I'm telling you like this. If you don't have topics, I'm going to talk about what I want. And if I want to talk about the movie, I'm going to talk about the fucking movie. Who the fuck do you think you are? Who the fuck do you think you are?
If you want
good. Hey,
if you want, hey, bro, if you want to talk about like Us or something, like next time, like if you want to talk about like current movies, I'm cool with that. I'm just like, if you want, if you come in here like, hey, let's talk about Pulp Fiction, I'm like, nah.
And then I'm gonna start talking about Pulp Fiction.
And then I'm gonna mute you. And then when you're done, we're gonna have another conversation.
And then I'm gonna start talking about another old movie. So, you know.
Say what?
And then I'm gonna start talking about another old movie I want. So you're gonna mute the whole thing, but I ain't gonna not talk about it. I'm gonna talk about what I want if you ain't got no structure. We're gonna have structure, or I'm gonna talk about what I want.
I mean,
you gonna
we can't make this no theme podcast. So I mean, what you mean?
It ain't gonna have no theme, but I'm just saying, like, beforehand, we're gonna have some bullet points. Wow. And I'm on too, because I started off talking about my love of cinema right now.
Yeah, but you talk about your love of cinema in the abstract. It's not like you watching the movies, you just watching people talk about the movies.
Yeah, and that is a bullet point to talk about.
Yeah, then, but I don't want to talk about that. If you came on here and was like, hey, bro, I just saw There Will Be Blood. I loved it. I'm like, yeah, let's talk about that. Or you said, I just saw Pulp Fiction again. Let's talk about it. I'm like, yeah, that's cool. If you want to get on here and just talk about what Pulp Fiction is in regard to, like, the videos you saw, I don't want to talk about that.
First of all, I've seen Pulp Fiction already.
I know you've seen Pulp Fiction. I'm not saying you haven't.
And also, if that's one point, I don't understand what you're talking about. I don't know why that would take up the whole thing.
If you have seen them, if you saw the movie recently and you had saw videos on it, I'm cool with that.
I just think you're not that interested.
If you come on here and you like, hey, look, I saw a couple of videos on, I don't know, saw a couple of videos on Back to the Future. This is like, what do you think about this? I'm like, I don't want to talk about that. Those are other people's ideas.
Okay. Here's what I think. I don't think you're that, and I think you need me to have stuff to talk about because you don't have much.
I mean, you are the other person, so I mean, I don't want it just to be me talking.
But the thing is, you don't. I usually start it, so I'm trying to figure out if I don't talk, will you ever? That's my point.
My only point was that I just don't.
My only point is I'm gonna talk about what I want to talk about. If you don't come with nothing to talk about, so you better have something to talk about. Otherwise, I'm gonna talk about.
So if I come here talking about, hey, bro, I just saw, I just rewatched Sunset Boulevard. Let's talk about that. You down?
You can talk. I'm gonna be on 2K waiting for you to stop.
So that's what you do when I'm talking?
Yeah.
Well, then what are we doing a podcast for?
I like it.
If nobody listening.
I listen. Now that I say I don't listen, I didn't say that. I said I'm going to be on 2K waiting until you're done.
Yeah. All right, well, cool.
So for the beginning of this season, you got to do much better.
I think I'm doing fine.
I think you're the weak link. I'll be honest with you.
Well, go do a podcast with Jazz then. How about that?
I actually think about it.
They do it. Kevin Smith did one with his wife for a while. It was really good.
Don't bring him up talking about me.
What you talking about? Y'all do podcasts, don't you?
I'm better than him.
At what?
Everything, first of all.
At what? What you mean?
Podcasting?
You better at podcasting? Dude got like 8 podcasts. And he interviews like really dope guests sometimes.
Do you know what it is to be a prodigy?
Are you asking me or are you telling me?
I'm asking, do you know what it is to be a prodigy?
I know what a prodigy is.
That is I.
A prodigy of what, though?
Podcasting. Giving content to the people.
Yeah, I don't want to call this show content, one. And two.
Content.
Huh?
We are content creators.
No, I'm not a content creator.
Why?
I don't make fuel for people.
This is fuel.
This ain't fuel. Fuel disposable. I'm cool.
You see, that's another thing. You don't like that word just because you hear it and you just want to be different.
I just don't like that word.
But this is, in fact, content, so I don't understand that gripe.
Do you mean content as a noun, or do you mean this is the content of the episode?
I think you know exactly what I'm... All right, man, I'm tired of talking to you.
Same, bro.
All right, hey, what's this called? Placeholder. All right, y'all, we're going to have a great season for y'all. So y'all just stay tuned to the greatness. We're going to have some guests on, I think.
I can't wait to this finals podcast get off. So we actually have a good in and out. A hot 30, and then we out.
A hot 30?
Yeah, it's going to be 30 minutes tops, and then we out. As soon as it hits 30, we're like, all right, we got to cut it off for the night.
I'm not cutting nothing off.
I'm cutting it off. What do you mean? 30 minutes is enough to talk about one basketball game.
Not if it's damn packed.
Yeah, I don't think we need more than 30 minutes on a basketball game.
You never know.
Yeah, I think a cool 30 is fine. I thought she just got fat. She's pregnant. Good for her. All right, well, we'll talk later.
Placeholder, yeah.